Invite you to join with us in the opening song. It's a call response. The choir will lead, and then Kim will turn around and look at you, and y'all will follow. You noticed I said y'all will follow. Good morning. It's a joy to have you here today as we gather to be the people of God on Epiphany Sunday, the day that we celebrate the wise men who finally made it to the manger. Now, if you have your creche put away, you got to take it out. And you got to get rid of everybody except Mary, Joseph, and the babe, and the wise men. But you also got to get rid of the manger. Because according to Matthew, they were in a home. So I'll let you think about that. But anyway, this is the day we come together reminding ourselves, whoever you are and wherever you may be, you are loved by God and you are welcome here. And we celebrate that, especially on this day. A couple of announcements. If you come to the church tomorrow, the parking lot will be closed because we're getting it restriped. So if you want to come to the office, you'll need to park over on Keedy Street. They'll be moving throughout the day. So it's a joy that we're getting it done. Also, church council will meet the 17th. It'll be a Zoom meeting. So please mark that down, 7 p.m. on the 17th, a Zoom meeting to take care of the business that is normal. We still have some poinsettias here. Please grab one. You can grab it during the sermon, give you something to do. But anyway, you can also grab it after the service. Sewing group. Anyway, for those of you who know the difference between sewing and sewing, it will once again start meeting fourth Mondays of the month. So they will meet at Lydia's Quilt and Crafts. For more information, you can call Marilyn or Hulda. This Wednesday, after voice is practiced, we're going to take down the lights because we get to start being the light rather than depending on all of these things to keep us light. So mark that down. We will have coffee hour afterwards. Invite you to come and be a part of that. And we still need folk to sign up to be scripture readers, to be ushers, to take care of the coffee time. But we're here to celebrate and be the people of God. For those of you who are joining us online, we're so glad you're here. And so I invite you for a moment to stand, wave at one another. We up front get the joy of waving to the camera. One another in the name of Christ.
Jesus Christ. Good morning. Thank you for joining us in worship today. Will you please join me with a call to worship? Our God is a God of power and strength. Our God is a God of majesty and awe. Our God is a God of glory and wonder. Our God calls us each by name.
God calls each of us to unite and worship together.
All right. The opening prayer we'll say together. Are you ready? Light of Christ, awaken us this hour to the glory of your presence in our midst. Shine among us in such a way that the darkness without and within may be pushed back, such that we might truly see what is real. Help us to recognize our sin for what it is. Enable us to behold the world as you created it to be, as you created us to be. Empower us to move from darkness to light, from sin to new life. May your light within us shine through worship this day as all our days. This we pray in the name of the Word made flesh, the light which is the light of all people, Jesus Christ. Amen. The scripture today, let's see, each gospel tells the story of Jesus in a different way. Each gospel uses their own sources as well as using sources that they share. Each gospel has a target audience. Today, we look at Matthew's focus. It is from Matthew that we get the story of the wise men. Matthew wants to let us know that Jesus comes not simply to the people of Israel, but to all people. Jesus is the one who comes to be the light of the world. Matthew 2, 1 through 12 in the Common English Bible. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in the territory of Judea during the rule of King Herod, Magi came from the east to Jerusalem. They asked, "Where is this newborn king of the Jews? We've seen his star in the east, and we've come to honor him." When King Herod heard this, he was troubled, and everyone in Jerusalem was troubled with him. He gathered all the chief priests and the legal experts and asked them where the Christ was to be born. They said, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for this is what the prophet wrote. You, Bethlehem, land of Judah, by no means are you least among the rulers of Judah, because from you will come one who governs, who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the Magi and found out from them the time when the star had first appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search carefully for the child. When you've found him, report to me so that I too may go and honor him." When they heard the king, they went and looked, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stood over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house and saw the child with Mary, his mother. Falling to their knees, they honored him. Then they opened their treasure chests and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Because they were warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they went back to their own country by another route. God's word for God's people. Amen.
Be free.
I invite you to join me in prayer. Lord, it's middle of winter, and yet we are here to proclaim the light. It's the middle of darkness, and we're here to live the light. It's the middle of frustration and anger and hurt, and we're here to be the presence of Christ. So gather us round your love. Let us be filled with your light so that we might be light to the world. Challenge us. Comfort us. Give us courage, humility, grace, and passion. We pray it in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen. There is so much about this gathering, this group of wise men. In fact, that's the first part. We're not sure they were all men. It just says they came from the east. We don't know that there were three. We can get that, you know, that's just tradition that's giving. And we know the name because of Menotti. You know, he wrote them all in the Night Visitors. And so we know their names. They were hidden for years and years and years. And Menotti, in serious study, found out that their names were Caspar, Melchior, and Belshazzar. And then there's all the fun stuff. I love the memes. I get on Facebook, I get Episcopal memes. And there's one where you see three wise men with looks of shock on their face and said, "We're the wise men and the shepherds beat us by 12 days? And we have no idea how long it took. Because if you remember, the star doesn't show up until Jesus was born. They're on the other side of a land that is impassable. You go up around through what's called the Fertile Crescent. And they didn't see it. Now, I will tell you, I saw the Christmas star. 2 or 3 years ago, there was an alignment of star and planet that made that exceptionally bright, and people said, that's what it must have been. Only took us 2,000 years to come up with that. There's a lot we don't know. There's a lot that is hidden in mystery. The 12 days of Christmas that remind us that there's a period of time. It looks like it may have been somewhere in the neighborhood of a couple of years. And what scholars say from that is that's because when Herod got mad after the wise men left in a different direction, he had all male children 2 years of age and younger killed, according to the tradition. So it was a period of time. But for Matthew, this gospel, remember, each of the gospels has an audience they're looking to, and Matthew is looking to tell his people that in Jesus, the Messiah is coming. The one who is light to the world is coming. Not only is coming, but is here. Jesus, the light of the world. And everybody, through him, the world will be blessed. And we've taken that on, and we said, isn't that wonderful? Isn't that exciting? Through Jesus, all the world is blessed. And we go back, and we continue to do what we've done before and live our lives the same way and say that Jesus has come into the world. The light is here. Y'all better find it. And we forget that Jesus invites us into a way of being. Remember last week when we talked about the disciples coming in and being named, and they were... The question was asked, where do you live? Where do you abide? Where is life centered in you? And Jesus says, come and follow me. The early people, they were not called Christians. The early followers of the anointed, followers of the Messiah, there are any kind of groups that name, recognized that it was stepping into a relationship of discipling, that is, of being like the disciple, like the master, walking in the footsteps of the master, learning what that master has to teach. Not simply gathering it in our head, but embodying it in our spirit, living it out. So that the question becomes not, do you know the light, but are you willing to be the light to the world? And that's an audacious question to ask these days. Because Anybody else feel like you're powerless? Like no matter what you do, it's not going to make any difference? You can be kind and loving, and somebody behind you is going to be snarky. You can talk about love and grace, and somebody's going to pull out a gun and prove their point. Or somebody's going to beat up someone simply because of the color of their skin, or the way they look, or the fact that they didn't let you first in line. You know, on and on. And there comes a time when we say, there is no light. We're in darkness. And we're stuck in darkness. And yet, in the midst of that, in this time when Jesus comes in the midst of occupation by Rome, and not a kind occupation, Rome was ruthless. They killed people at whim. If they didn't like you, if someone in the leadership didn't like you, you were dead. If you had the audacity to stand up in front and argue with them or suggest that maybe they were not right, excuse me, you could be dead. Life was nothing for them, for those who were not Roman. They could do what they wanted. A dark, dark time. And yet, an audacious statement is made. In this baby, in this one who is living in a house where his parents are soon going to be forced to leave because this oppressive regime is out to kill, light comes. And the challenge for us, the challenge for us as the people of God, is to let that light come in and to believe the light, to believe the presence of God, to believe that in God we can be co-creators of a new world. It begins with us. It begins with us here as we gather to remind ourselves that all who come are part of the family of God, that all who love are welcomed and accepted. There's a part of us as people of faith that have this puritanical mindset that says the church is here to remind you how far you are from being perfect. And when you're perfect, you can come and join me in church. When you get it all worked out, as soon as you don't need forgiveness, you can have it. Sort of like as soon as you don't need a loan, you can have it. But as soon as you get your stuff all together, then you can come and join us. This sanctuary for the saints, where we all sit around and polish our crowns and talk about how good we are and how those poor slobs out there, if they really wanted to, could become like us. And those poor slobs out there are saying, I don't want nothing to do with y'all. But that light that comes in that says, we in our darkness found this one who is light. This one who met us exactly where we are and loves us when we are not yet perfect, before we knew we needed it, before we knew what sin was, we were loved by God, and nothing changes that. And sainthood and all of that stuff is not a sense that they were perfect, but that God loved them in their humanity. God loves us in the midst of our humanity. God gives the light of God's love freely, totally. It is there, it is ours. And then God gives us an opportunity to share that light wherever we are, without knowing what's going to happen when we do it. It's not one of those things that, well, I tried to talk to them once about God's love. I tried to live God's love for them, and they turned me down, so no more. But again and again and again. How many people talk to you about the love of God? How many people lived before you the love of God until you came to a point where you said, there might be something about this? It wasn't the first time, I can guarantee it. May not have been the 5th or the 100th or the 500th, but somewhere along the line, that you saw in them something so amazing, something so wonderful, something that you were drawn to, and the light came into you, and the light grows in you. And now the responsibility is for us to be the light to the world, to be the grace of God to the world. Not easy, because it means that we will be laughed at. Let me tell you a story about someone who gave his life for another. Let me tell you about the possibility of hope. Let me tell you about a little girl in Germany who said, in spite of everything, I believe that people are still good. And Frank? That audacious love that we get to be a part of, that we get to build here in a county, here in a town, here in a church, where we recognize that God comes in the midst of our humanity. I'm reading a book by Nadia Boltz-Weber that's called Accidental Saints. It's a wonderful book. She's an amazing author. But she writes about discovering in Denver a church that was founded in late 19th, early 20th century, I don't remember exactly where, that was started by a woman who was a progressive. And she thought, this is wonderful. And then she read that this woman was a part of the KKK and a part of this and a part of that. And she said, this woman that I had made into a saint, I wanted to rip her sainthood from her. And yet, when she talked to a friend of hers, another clergy person said, I will put her name down as one of the saints. To recognize that sainthood comes not because we're wonderful, great people who never, ever, ever do anything wrong, but because we do our best in our world to live out the love of God. Do the best you can until you know better, and then be better. Empowered by the grace and love of God. Empowered by that light that we know. It may not be practical. It may not be practical to love people who are going to hate us, but it is the way of faith. It may not be practical to turn the other cheek, and yet it is who God calls us to be. It may not be practical, but it's who God empowers us to be people who believe in something that is audacious, something that is amazing, something that transforms, something that leads us forward. Especially in this year, we get to be light of God's love. We get to be those who say, we will stand for grace. We will stand for community. We will stand for possibility. We will stand for that day when hunger and thirst and alienation are no more. We will stand for that day when one of my heroes reminds us that we will be known by the content of our character rather than the color of our skin. We stand for that day when all are loved by God. I remember reading, again, from another of my heroes, Desmond Tutu. We don't believe in a Christian God because God is not Christian. Think about that. We believe in a God who is greater than us. We live out our faith through Jesus Christ. But a God of love welcomes, empowers, reaches out. One of Bishop Tutu's dear friends, the Dalai Lama, wrote a book together. It's amazing. We believe in a God who invites us to move beyond ourselves to more than we think we can be, who invites us to join together with one another, with others, and create that world, and to know that we have absolutely no idea how it's going to be done, other than it's going to be done with grace and love and courage and humility and believing that God is at work and will work through us to bring about the reign of God in the world. I invite you to join me. I invite you to join in what is going to be an amazing, amazing year. We wear masks now as a sign of solidarity, as a sign that we will believe, that we believe in community, and that we will care for one another, and that we'll be kind to one another. And maybe someday we won't wear them. But whether we wear them or not, we are a community. Whether we ask, are you vaccinated or not? We do it as a community. We do it recognizing that God is inviting us to care for our sisters and brothers. We have an amazing year ahead of us. Together, let's be the people of God. Thanks be to God who is and was. Amen. As we come into prayer, I was just going to come to you.
I just want to say that 69 years ago, my husband and I were married, and we invite you to come back and have a cup of tea or a cup of coffee to celebrate our anniversary.
Oh, all right. 69 years. I just added 10 years to it. 69 years. Congratulations. It's a joy. And also a joy, Jack, to see you back. Back from surgery, it's good to see you here. Good to celebrate that God is at work, bringing healing, wholeness, celebration. And also God meets us in the midst of life where we would call out in our pain and heartache, sorrow and fear. So I invite you as we come into prayer, it'll be a time when you can share your joys or concerns. If you're watching us online, please in the chat, Box, please lift that up, and we will keep that going in prayer as well. So let's go to God in prayer. Gracious and glorious God, God who comes to us in the most humble of situations and lives for us a life not of ostentatiousness, but a life of humility, a life of courage, of standing up to powers that be and showing, Paul called that, still more excellent way. Who was willing to challenge, was willing and lovingly accepted all, sinner, outcast, rich, famous. They were all part of your creation. God, lead us as church to move into that welcoming, gracious community that calls us to live as siblings, calls us to learn and grow, calls us to repent and live in new ways. Lord, help us to be uncomfortable when we have become far too comfortable. And help us to comfort those whose hearts are broken, those whose spirits are downtrodden, those who wonder if anybody cares. Help us to change, to become, to be. And so, God, in this time, we would call out to you the celebrations that are part of our lives. We would call out to you our hurt and our heartache, our pains. And we'll trust that in this amazing choir of voice, you will hear our hearts, and you will welcome them as we wrap them in arms of love and raise them to you. So I invite you to call out now joys or concerns, hopes, fears.
My brother and his wife with that COVID.
May these come to you as our spirits, as our words wrapped in your love, wrapped in the love that we have. And Lord, help us to be your prayer in action, to believe in you, to walk in your way, to follow in your way, to bring about the new reign of God. A welcome, inclusive, just society. And we pray all this in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus, the one who teaches us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now is a time we come of giving of our tithes and offerings to the building up of the body of Christ, to helping to create that new world. You can support the church in a number of ways. You can put your offering in the offering plate at the back of the church. You can drop it off. The office is open 9 to noon, Monday through Thursday. If we're not here, you can put it in the mail slot where it is safe. You can go to our website, fumcroseburg.org, and follow the Give Now buttons and give that way. You can also go to the Vanco app. If you still have the Give Plus app, that is sunsetting at the end of this month, so I encourage you to go to Vanco. And I will tell you from using it that Vanco is much easier to use. You again go to Vanco, go to Roseburg United Methodist Church, follow the prompts, and give. But the money that comes in goes to make a difference for people's lives, to help feed the hungry and clothe the naked, to proclaim an acceptable year of the Lord, to touch lives in new ways, and I am proud to be part of a community that continues to live the body, live the grace of Jesus Christ. So I invite you to give joyously, and I invite you to give in the love of God. Join with me in a prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks for all these gifts and for those who give. We thank you for all people. We thank you that you have blessed us that we might bless others. So use these gifts that we have, our times, our talents, and our treasures, to share the love of God. We pray it in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
I dance to the morning.
My brothers and sisters in Christ, God invites you to be part of the dance. God invites you to be part of the light. Go share the light of God wherever you go. Share it at home, at work. Share it in the stores. Share it on the highway, wherever you go. And the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the empowering presence of the Holy Spirit go with you now and forever. Amen.